Hello and welcome to the Media Play News Podcast. I'm your host, Charles Parkman.
And I'm co-host, Charlie Scholey.
This week will be a little more focused than usual because it's going to be all about animation. Charlie's turning me loose to talk about recent and upcoming animated movies and the general trends we've been seeing around them. First is the impending release of Puss in Boots: The Last Wish on Peacock and how its animation style is influenced by other movies. Then we'll turn to Crunchyroll, who may have made an industry-shaking announcement that will be dissected. It's a huge deal and we're definitely not over-exaggerating anything. Before all that, let's catch up. Anything new you've seen, Charlie?
Just same old, because I've been busy with the move back into my house. It's going great. I have no couch, and the TV is just sitting in its box, leaning against the wall. But, you know, it's like the potential is there. So I've just still been watching the same couple of shows, like lying on my back with my laptop on my stomach. Last of Us is good again. They had their second to last episode of the season last night. The last couple episodes have been kind of slow. It's been more of like character building stuff than straight action. But this last episode, if you saw the first couple episodes and thought they were pretty good, and then someone who played the game went and told you, like, hey, if you thought those were good, you ain't seen nothing yet. Well, this would be that episode that they were talking about. Have you watched any more of Last of Us since we last talked about it?
Since we last talked about it, my partner and I watched the second episode. So
there you go.
Not even close to caught up.
At that rate, you'll be finished with season one by the time season two comes out.
Look, we are finding a place and moving. Once we're settled,
yeah,
we'll try to blast through it.
Priorities.
By the time we're settled, it'll be finished. Best way to watch a series.
Yeah, you have 1 week. And then, like you were saying last episode, the Party Down revival season is out. Episodes 1 and 2 via Stars are out. I saw them both. They're just like the original two seasons of the show. It's amazing.
I'd love to see it.
Yeah. It's actually like shocking how similar the characters and just the overall mood and tone of the show like are the same compared to the original, considering it's like 13 years or so since. Like, I saw the first episode of the revival season, and then I just went back and saw the first episode of the show, and they're basically just like the same.
That's rad.
So I don't know if you've seen any of it yet, Charles, but anybody who likes Party Down is going to be in love with this.
Yeah, I might put that on while I'm putting stuff away in here.
Mm-hmm. And then last, that South Korean reality show, Physical 100, they must have been listening to the show last week when I was saying that all the games the contestants were competing in were too samey. So the show went back in time and reshot the episodes I haven't seen yet and shook up the games. The next episode I saw, instead of having the same game repeated like 5 or 6 times among the teams, they split the contestants up and had them compete in sort of micro games against each other. So one that I can talk about is 4 people each have to hold a 100-pound ball over their heads, and the winner is the person who can hold it the longest. Now, Charles, can you tell me how long the winner held his ball over his head? It's going to be longer than what you say. No matter what number you say, it's going to be longer, and it's going to be much longer than what you think.
Okay, having done, you know, similar exercises, what I did some apprentice physical therapy with my special needs students back when I was in education, and based on how long I could do it when I was in probably the best shape I've ever been in, I'm gonna say longer than 30 minutes.
2 hours. The answer was 2 hours. Jesus, so you know, these people are in pretty good shape.
I don't think I can do any single physical task for 2 hours.
I can't stand for 2 hours. I'll just put it that way. Like my legs will get tired. I'll have to kind of like shift my weight from one foot to the next. Right. And that's just standing still.
Yeah. You do one continuous act of stillness for 2 hours. It's insane.
Yeah. And just imagine the more impressive part of that game is the show made people standing still for 2 hours doing nothing interesting to watch. So, you know, applause all around to the production team, reality. Physical 100.
Yeah, reality television's not messing around. They've been at it for a long time.
Mm-hmm. How about you this week?
Didn't really get a chance to watch too much, aside from passively watching stuff while I work. So this, as you know, the trend of the last couple weeks has been I just pick a Justice League movie at random from HBO Max, and I have that playing in the background since I've seen all of them. And last week I watched Justice League versus the Fatal Five. It was a technically canon film to the DC animated universe, which started with Batman animated series and ended with Justice League Unlimited. I think it's the second film to come out, animated movie to come out, that's in continuity with those movies. While I don't think it's good, it is better than the other one, Batman and Harley Quinn. But yeah, that's pretty much it. I don't have a lot to say about Justice League versus Fatal Five. I don't think it's worth watching if you're not already super invested in the watching all of these. So not a wreck. I do not recommend watching Justice League versus the Fatal Five.
Okay, you heard it here first.
if you've heard about it at all, you definitely heard it. You probably heard it here first. But before we get into the main bit, this week's inspiration is the Angry Orchard Crisp Apple Hard Cider, because I'm tired of the Costco scotch and I haven't bought liquor in a while.
Yeah, you've probably got like 3/4 of that bottle left to go, because Costco doesn't sell anything smaller than gallons.
Oh, no, I'm down to about 1/4 of the bottle. I just didn't want to drink another 2 glasses of it on the podcast.
I myself, now that I have access to my alcohol store again, I am drinking Bombarda Caribbean Dark Rum mixed with some ginger ale. It's really good.
I mean, classic rum ginger ale. Nothing to mess up there.
Nope. I didn't even measure anything. I just poured it in until the ratio looked right.
You pour with your heart and you're never going to steer yourself wrong. That's how I make drinks. That's how I recommend everyone makes drinks. Unless it's your job to be a bartender, in which case, don't do that, because you'll pour too much and you'll lose the bar too much money.
Yeah. Yeah. The amount extra that you'll make in tips, you'll lose on getting fired for giving away too much alcohol.
And even my friends who are bartenders, also, when they're not on the clock, pour with their heart. So anyone who's like not a bartender by trade, but is like weird in particular about making drinks at like house parties or whatever, just don't be friends with that person. just do what you want. If you want to be particular about your cocktails, do it at home. With, you know, just in the privacy of your own home, you can be as particular as you want. But if you're at a house party and people are making drinks and you're trying to be all like, you know, I read, you know, this cocktail book that so-and-so recommended on so-and-so on such and such show 20 years ago, and now I want to show off all my cocktail knowledge, you're in the wrong environment for it. Have a small dinner party and do it there. If we're hanging out and people, if we're playing beer pong, don't mix the cocktail. Like,
you're at the wrong party.
Pick your spirit, pick your mixer, go to town. But this isn't a drinking podcast. This is a home media podcast. So let's get into some home media talk. Peacock is doing more than live streaming premieres of their shows with their lead actors. It's adding several high-profile movies to its content library, including Megan, Tar, Violet Knight, Nope, and most prominently, Puss in Boots: The Last Wish. More and more often, the window between a theatrical release and a streaming release is a handful of weeks, averaging around 21 days. This is an interesting movie because it gained a strong word of mouth following since its release because of its story and animation style, the subject of which we'll be talking about. So Puss in Boots is, you know, it's a spinoff of the Shrek series. And the first one came out in 2011. So I think like 2 or 3 years after Shrek the Third or Shrek Forever After, whichever one. It was probably Shrek the Third. Nope, Shrek the Third was 2011. Forever After was 2010. So it was the first spinoff off of the, as of now, final Shrek movie.
Wow, they were cranking him out at that point.
Yeah, dude. Shrek is 2001, Shrek 2 is 2004, Shrek the Third is 2007, and Shrek Forever After is 2010. So like that's 3 years apart for each one. Like the minimum amount of time it takes to make, record, and animate like a CG film, they like went for it. And they get considerably better every single time, animation-wise. Shrek the Third is kind of a dud of the four. I think Shrek Forever After is pretty solid and definitely looks the best. Considering it is the fourth one and they've been like cranking it out since like 1997. If you know the history behind the development, the first Shrek film took a long time, but they seem to have really refined the formula. But yeah, Puss in Boots is the first, was the first like, and I think as of now, only spinoff.
Yeah.
Of the Shrek series.
I was just having like a flashbulb memory of, was there a series of short films featuring the Gingerbread Man? But I think I just invented that like right
now. No, there were shorts on the DVDs.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, all the DVDs had their own short, had like shorts. There were like a handful of holiday specials they did with Nickelodeon. And then it ended up on where like Netflix exclusive for a while. But yeah, Puss in Boots is the first spinoff. And the first Puss in Boots is very much the exact same art style as the Shrek films. And then there was, I think, a sequel that went directly to Netflix. It may have been released theatrically, but there was definitely a second Puss in Boots movie back in, I think, 2014.
Yeah, your hesitancy in recalling it is a good indicator for how popular that movie was.
Yeah, I think that one was like, I know for a fact that there was a Puss in Boots Netflix series following the characters of the second film, which is why like I can't remember if that was a theatrical release or a streaming release. But it was like really interesting when an additional Puss in Boots film was announced for, you know, 2023 or 2022, when the trailer came out, which I didn't see because I was not interested in Puss in Boots.
Yeah, who was?
But the clips from the trailer started to hit Twitter, and where I saw it for the first time and saw like how staggeringly different, while still being like recognizable as that art style, like a similar art style that you would, you know, recognize from the Shrek movies. Everything was like very dynamic. There was like the colors were more like stood out a whole lot more. The animation style was very flashy, and it was very reminiscent of Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, the 2018 movie from Sony. While I haven't seen the film yet, I wanted to see it in theaters, but you know, circumstances being as they were, didn't happen. But every clip I've seen from Puss in Boots: The Last Wish looks incredible. Like,
yeah,
I've been CG animation has looked in a long time.
Yeah, I've been waiting for this to come to streaming just because, like, by the time I actually wanted to see it, it wasn't playing anywhere locally.
Yeah.
And just for the animation style alone, I want to see what's going on with this, because at least growing up, Pixar was the de facto animated movies company. And then there was DreamWorks, but they kind of felt like, you know, bargain bin Pixar. Like they had Shrek, which is really, really good from a story point of view. But the animation quality was noticeably, let's say, different, if you want to be charitable with it. And all animated stuff, not only is it geared towards kids as just like the target demographic, but the animation just feels very, very samey. But only in the last 5 years or so, it feels like there's a lot more mainstream animated movies that are like taking a really sharp left turn away from like Pixarification of animated features.
Yeah, in particular, like some recent examples of like ones that look very, so a trend that's been happening with, you know, CG animated movies in the last, I don't know, maybe 3 or 4 years has been, there's a lot less of a commitment to like realistic rigging you know, when you're, you know, animated, generally when you're animating something with computers, there's usually like, you know, a rigging skeleton that they, you know, put the model over. And so while things can look, you know, cartoony, like you can have high fantasy stuff like, you know, How to Train Your Dragon and
Tangled. There's another like one.
That. Yeah. Like things were like, you know, you can have, even if they're non-humanoid, there's generally a skeleton and then the model is, you know, animated around that skeleton. And the model is rigged to that skeleton is where the term ring comes from. And so there's like a very, by necessity of doing that in 3D space, there's still a realistic quality to it. And
like the characters are constrained to the skeleton they're fixed to.
Yeah, everything moves as you would expect it to in 3D space, you know, exaggerated physics notwithstanding. But one of the tenets of like one of the things that makes traditional and 2D animation distinct is you're not limited to like how something would move in space or even like how the model itself looks in between things because of how animation works, you know, by being at least 12 frames per second, our brain just kind of does the rest. So that's where like, you know, there's memes of like smear frames, which is the frames in between two like solid model frames where you just have to show, you know, movement. And so there'll be, you know, extra eyes or whatever, like a face will be really stretched out or like there'll be multiple limbs at once. That's because our eyes are looking for those signs of motion. And so you can draw those in between still frames where the character model is standing still. But there's like principles in animation like squash and stretch where you can exaggerate the features in order to convey movement in a way that you can't if you're using a rigged model. So a trend so movies have been, and different animation studios have been moving away from that and taking advantage, like using squash and stretch with even like humanoid characters. So like a good example that I haven't seen actually seen yet, but a Netflix movie, Mitchell's versus the Machines. That was relatively early COVID example, like COVID release. It was like, this is different. We're doing 2D animation principles, but using 3D as like our medium. And that opens you up to like a lot more expression. Turning Red from Pixar also did that. And Pixar, like, you know, famously kind of made that rigging system work in a like a fluid way, kind of for the first time. You can watch all the early Pixar shorts on Disney Plus now. And you can kind of see them developing that technology to the point where, like, the reason Toy Story was such a big deal is because no one else could do that at the time. Like, the rigging process was so lengthy and difficult that trying to do an entire feature seemed unreasonable. And Pixar figured it out, and you can, you know, watch their shorts, and they didn't quite get it with people because skin has like weird, that's a texture thing more than animation thing, but like, you know, getting people to look good enough that it doesn't, you know, freak us out took a while even still. But that's why, like, looking at the toys in the first Toy Story, that animation still really holds up.
Yeah. Because... What's funny about that, when I was recording out of my in-laws' house for the last couple months, some kids that were there for like daycare, there would be Toy Story playing for them. And so I would happen to see some scenes just like here and there. And given how old that movie is, it is shocking how well it's kind of aged.
Yeah, the movie's 25 years old.
Yeah. Meanwhile, the humans in that movie look pretty much more toy-like than the actual toys in it.
Yeah. Yeah. If you don't look at the people or Sid's dog, everything looks pretty comparable to now. Like, if you look at Toy Story 1 and Toy Story 4, I think like the biggest shift, like if you look at Woody from those two films, the biggest thing is just like they got really good at texture in the intervening 20 years. And so, you know, all of his stitches and like the cloth that makes up his body looks like real cloth just on, you know, a toy. like Woody in Toy Story 4 looks like a Woody you could go buy today. Because like the textures and everything are that, you know, realistic now. But yeah, it's been like, it's been interesting watching that shift. And I think one of the earliest examples of that was 2018 Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, and where like, because they're like trying to emulate comic books, they like apply this effect to a lot of the character models where it looks like the colors are layered over each other. Like if you read older comic books, even like, you know, you have to go back that far, even like as recently as like the late 80s, early into the mid 90s. Sometimes when you pick up your issue, the colors would not quite be lined up from how they were printed. And so you would have this like slight overlap in either direction. And so that's how they colored the film. Like when you watch a lot of the sequences, they're slightly off. And so it almost gives off like a 3D effect, even, you know, I think it may have been released in 3D. Like even if you're, you know, watching the normal version of it, there's kind of a 3D effect because the colors are just slightly off. And they also deliberately reduce the frame rate on specific characters at specific times to make them stand out more. You know, in the context of the film, it's like used to show these characters are from different universes, and so they're slightly out of sync with the one that we're watching. And it's really effective, and they like play with perspective and
They do a lot of cool stuff with the camera work in that, which is, you know, it's funny to say because it's animation, so obviously there's no camera, but they're a lot more clever with how they present the action on screen. And yeah. I feel like Puss in Boots is doing the same thing based on just what I've seen with it.
Yeah, definitely like an evolution of like that process. You know, it's from DreamWorks and not Sony Animation, but you know, people are seeing each other's work and are developing in, you know, different directions. So it definitely seems like an evolution of like that style. And I'm really excited to see more stuff. Actually, just today, as of recording, there was a teaser trailer. I mean, it was almost a full trailer. It was almost 2 minutes long. There was a trailer for the upcoming Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie, Mutant Mayhem.
I had no idea this was even planned until I saw it mentioned.
Yeah, they kind of kept it, unless you're like plugged into like Ninja Turtles stuff. Nickelodeon, who's producing it because they own the distribution right, like the film and television rights to the franchise as of right now. They've kind of been keeping it under wraps because they just released a movie based on the last animated series, Rise of the TMNT, which I think aired from like 2020 to 2022. But for whatever reason, Nickelodeon's been doing this thing where like they have a Ninja Turtles show, they run it for two seasons, and then they take a year off, and then they start a new show. Kind of frustrating. Like, I imagine, especially if you're, like, really getting into something, it's probably frustrating to be like, no, you got two seasons, and then it's over. You don't get any more of that. But there's been, like, you know, each show has found an audience, and they've all seemed to have done pretty well. But that team was just able to release a film to wrap up the series that released on Netflix a couple months ago. But so I feel like they've been keeping it Mayhem's development under wraps because they didn't want to overshadow the Rise movie. But we basically didn't know anything until today when they released the trailer, and there was also a, you know, press release that had the name, like the cast and everything. But it also has a very distinct, visually interesting animation style, and it just looks a lot of fun.
Yeah, it's kind of like, you know, for me looking at it without that much like vocabulary to articulate the art style of it, it's like if you took the dynamic new 2D animation style that Puss in Boots or Spider-Man has and crossed it with claymation, you'd almost end up with what this Ninja Turtles movie looks like.
Yeah, it does almost look like a claymation film. Like it looks like these are models that they've gotten to move, and like animation, you know, it just, I'm really interested to see, I'm excited for animation again. I'm an animation nerd. I really like the process of animation. And it was a real bummer when Disney announced like they weren't doing traditionally animated films anymore, like traditional 2D animated films. The last one was 2011's Winnie the Pooh. And that they basically put that one out there to like die, largely because Princess and the Frog underperformed. That was released in 2009. And that was like, from what I've read, around the time they were already like, they were making moves to acquire Pixar. So the deal with Pixar was like, Pixar was an independent studio and Disney just had to, you know, purchase distribution rights. And that worked out, you know, for a decade. And so Disney was finally like, what if we just bought you? And so they did. But they were like kind of in the process of doing that around 2006, 2007. And we're already like starting to move into other things. I think Frozen was under production around that time. They'd done other CG films that were non-Pixar, like Meet the Robinsons and Bolt, which nobody saw. And a handful of other things.
I forgot that movie existed until you just brought it up.
Yeah, man. John Travolta and Miley Cyrus is both at the peak of their fame. So they're already kind of moving away from 2D animation, probably because the process of CG animation is a little bit faster and less expensive. So they were kind of moving away from it already. And so there was a lot put on Princess and the Frog, and it underperformed. And so I think at that point, the higher ups at Disney at the time were like, well, 2D is not the wave anymore. Our competitors are, you know, DreamWorks had fully transitioned to doing CG stuff, led by John Katzenberg, who left Disney under less than ideal circumstances. He's also maybe the worst person in maybe like the most like difficult person to work with in media at the time. But that's a different conversation. You can watch. Just look up, or sorry, it's Jeffrey Katzenberg. Just type Jeffrey Katzenberg into YouTube and you'll get tons of people ranting about how that dude almost ruined animation for everybody just because he didn't get the promotion he wanted in the early 90s. So yeah, they were ready to like write off 2D animation. Princess and the Frog underperforms. Winnie the Pooh is basically put out because it was mostly already finished, but it had very little marketing. Just kind of floundered that summer. And then they kind of used that to justify, all right, well, we'll just transition into, you know, Pixar will still be doing Pixar things. They still have creative control over their stuff. And then we'll also do our own stuff. So then that's how we get, you know, Frozen and Moana and, you know, stuff, all the stuff we've gotten since from there. And while the quality of those films is solid, they're good movies. There's just something about 2D animation that I feel until recently allowed for like a lot more visual expression because it's not limited to what you can do in 3D space. You can do literally whatever you want. Like even, and I think it's, if you compare like Frozen to the original Aladdin, and like there's, you know, magic stuff happening in Frozen, but like how visually interesting it can be is kind of limited by like the fact that humanoid 3D characters have to move around in that space, whereas like you see some of the stuff that, you know, the genie does in Friend Like Me, that whole sequence, space doesn't mean anything, so you can do whatever you want. You can like, you know, move the character can transform into whatever. There's interesting stuff you can do with the backgrounds that you don't like worry about. You know, you mentioned, you know, camera work in a, you know, animated film. Like there is a, while there is, it's a virtual camera, there is a like degree of shot composition you have to consider when you're working in 3D space that you don't really have to consider in the same way working in 2D space. You don't have to render things that aren't going to be there. Like you only have to draw what's going to be within the frame. You draw a little bit outside of it. And then that's really all you have to worry about. So it really frees you up to like do really interesting stuff with perspective and the shapes and form and movement of the characters.
Yeah, like you're saying about 2D animation giving you the freedom of expression, it's like we're going from getting away from just like everything looking sort of like a Pixar movie to, well, now the rules for what animation can be aren't as clearly defined anymore. So it gives people like a lot more freedom to render things however they want to. And like some stuff is going to look bad. Some stuff is going to look different. And then some stuff is really, really going to hit. And yeah. I'm looking forward to another few years when people figure out like what's the next thing to jump to, like how Pixar did with Toy Story 25 years ago. And I can't wait for it.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's definitely space for a resurgence of other animation styles. Like a couple years ago, there was Kubo and the Two Strings, which is a stop motion film. Yeah, so, you know, Wendell and Wild, which released just last year, the same director as Nightmare Before Christmas, he's never stopped. The name is Henry Selick. Never stopped doing.
I thought Tim Burton did Nightmare Before Christmas.
He produced it, and it's probably the main reason that film got made, because he had a lot of star power at the time, and Disney had missed out on letting him make a movie while he so Tim Burton was an animator at Disney Studios for a while, and he kept pitching movies, and they kept not wanting to make them, and so he left. And he did Edward Scissorhands and Batman back to back. And they were like, well, hey, Tim, you want to do anything you want?
I'm just imagining him being kind of like the annoying office person of like, oh, man, here comes Tim. He's going to try and pitch us with another one of his ridiculous ideas. Hey, guys, what if there was a guy who looks like he had really pointy fingers and his name was Edward? Edward Scissorhands. What do you have to say about that? Tim, get out of here. Yeah, maybe one day we can make that.
And then they didn't. But yeah, like 2D animation or stop motion animation, I think like there are so many good stop motion like animated films that didn't get the attention they deserved, especially for considering like how intensive like that process is, which is probably why more studios don't want to take the chance, because it costs a lot of money, because of just like how labor intensive it is. But there are rumors that Disney is looking to produce another 2D animated film. They're just rumors right now, but because they did close their studios back in, I think, 2012.
Actually, there's one recent example I can think of. It's the What If series they did on Disney Plus.
Well, What If series is actually a 3D animated series.
Oh, okay. Never mind. I don't know what I'm talking about.
It just has it's similar to cel shading, but like, it's not. It's like a different style that kind of gives it a more flat look.
Yeah, like
I
saw a little bit of it and it stuck out in my head as just kind of like, this is animation, but slightly different.
Yeah, it is 3D animated, which is still like a big deal for, the MCU to not only like produce an animated series, but also like let it be canon to the rest of their universe.
Yeah, it's kind of like a safe animation style. Oh, I absolutely think.
It is not like, it's not really groundbreaking in any considerable way. The animation's not great, I would say. It is like, it gives them a little bit of freedom, but it is very like, it's very stiff. It's not very detailed. It's mostly just like, this is a fun thing to do because you already know what these characters look like. So you can kind of like, you get it. It's basically like what that series is. It's like shrugging at you. Like, you get it, right? We're going to tell like a different story, but like, you get it. And that's like how they're kind of leaning on that animation style. But there's, like I said, there are rumors that there might be some 2D animation stuff coming out of Disney with an adaptation of the French folktale Bluebeard. But nothing has been confirmed as of right now. I mean, they still have, I think they do still, like, they outsource some animation. Like, there's a sequence in Moana that's still 2D animated. They'll do, like, for smaller, like, they'll do smaller sequences within their CG films that are 2D animated, but they don't have an in-house studio anymore that exclusive, or at least not for features. They do still do traditional animation for, you know, their television and streaming stuff. So I don't know. It'll be interesting to see how the next couple years go, because since Spider-Verse, it seems like people are getting a lot looser and, like, more experimental with their with their computer animated stuff. Like, from Pixar, Turning Red is a great example. Like, Turning Red could be a the way, like, they take advantage of, like, this is animation. We don't need everything to be, like, moving realistically. Let's do some fun, cool stuff. And so, like, it looks like a, you know, it's three-dimensional, but it looks like also an anime from the 90s. And, like, it's just fun.
Yeah, well, it's good that you bring that up, because I have a question for you, Charles. Do you like anime?
In theory, even though I don't watch a whole lot of it anymore.
Yeah, because I'd say the one major failing that animation has, you know, even if it's getting a little more experimental, for the most part, it's still geared towards younger audiences. What about us adults? What sort of animation do we have? For the most part, we kind of just have anime. And I have good news, because the folks at Sony and Crunchyroll also think you like anime. They've partnered together to add a one-click button on one of their smart TV remotes to take you directly to Crunchyroll, just like how they add a Netflix button to smart TV remotes, where they will host 18,000 plus hours of anime content of over 44,000 episodes and feature films. This is going to be on Sony's Bravia line of smart TVs.
And about 5,000 hours of that, you probably need to confirm that you're 18 in order to watch.
Yeah, I don't know if they even host that kind of anime on services like that.
I mean, Crunchyroll has some, from what I've heard, there's some stuff that, like, pushes it. It's definitely not for children. I mean, a lot of anime is not for children. Animation is taken more seriously in other parts of the world than it is in the U.S. And by more seriously, I mean it's not looked at in a general sense as being for children. So there are, like, you know, there's some adult themes, but anime is kind of infamous for having what we'll call fan service for the purpose of this podcast. and what would otherwise not be, you know, suggestive stories. There'll be some things that, you know.
Yeah, like you, in theory, I like anime too. But 9 times out of 10, whenever I try and watch something that's recommended, I just have to shut it off within, like, half of the first episode.
Yeah.
But it's really compelling to me that the popularity of that format has gotten to the point where a major company is adding an anime button to their remotes just to be able to turn that on. I mean, like,
yeah,
I don't think that that's going to add any more viewers to the Crunchyroll streaming service, which, if you didn't know, it's just an anime focused streaming platform, you know, Netflix, but everything is a Japanese cartoon. My opinion, they may as well call it the no girlfriend button, because if you want to be really, really uncharitable with it, the stereotypical person who is enthusiastic about anime is also the type of person who's just like a closet shut in. But I don't watch this stuff all that much. I just want to be clear. I don't want to be, like, too mean to any anime enthusiasts listening to this. But like I said, most of the time when I watch it, it's just like fan service nonsense that I would be ashamed if anybody saw me watching that type of stuff.
That's for the privacy. That's so, like, Yeah, The Last of Us, probably not. They don't, probably didn't intend for you to watch it on your laptop, on your stomach, in bed. That's probably, like, if you're going to be watching, you know, some of these more salacious animes, that's where you do, that's where you watch it in that format. That's when you're just, the door is closed, your partner's out of the house, in the dark with the door closed, and it's like, you know, your Lion April is playing, which is a slice of life anime that I have not watched, but I used to hear reference a lot on a podcast I used to listen to. But like, so I don't think that these kind of buttons really make a huge difference in terms of like, exposing new people to a thing. So like, for example, I'm holding my PS5 remote, also made by Sony, and the four streaming button services it has are Disney Plus, Netflix, Spotify, and YouTube. So I don't know if that's like, maybe, you know, they did some market research for like what people are streaming on their Sony consoles, and we're like, these are the four that are, one, willing to pay us the most money, and two, our market data shows that people are going to, you know, most likely want to have quick access to these things. Netflix and YouTube for sure makes sense to me. Disney Plus, I think, is interesting, but that one probably comes down to money. And Spotify is an interesting one, but it's also the only music app that's available on the PS5.
Yeah, like, right, it's weird that Spotify would show up there. When I think about kind of like the one-click buttons I see on smart TVs, which, by the way, the TV I mentioned I have at the top of the episode is a smart TV. I'm about to have one, and I have never used one of these buttons. I would rather click the menu button and then write a bunch of times till I find the streaming service of choice. So I don't think that there being an anime button is going to change anything, but I think it is a pretty good indicator of the types of things that the general public likes to watch. Because, you know, if you look at Vudu's like top titles of the last week, which I have as my homepage whenever I open a browser.
I just get their emails every week.
Yeah. So like, we talked about Puss in Boots for like 30 minutes straight, and yet Dragon Ball Super Superhero was at spot number 4 while Puss in Boots was spot number 5. So yeah, it's like, people like watching this stuff, and it's of the animes I've watched that are actually watchable, they do address a lot more mature content than Pixar type movies do. Most of the time it's garbage, but of the times where it's trying to like say something important, it's a lot better than any kind of, you know, Western animated content does.
Oh yeah. Because in, you know, Japan, they treat like animation as a medium, like it's just another tool for like effective storytelling. It does present like a very broad range of types of stories being told, types of like, you know, different art styles being used. Like I said, like I don't have anything against anime as a medium. I tend to go back to the anime that I watched as a young teenager. Like I watch, I just probably every 2 or 3 years, I watch all of Dragon Ball Z again. And I have been keeping up with those movies, but I haven't seen any of Super. So like even like newer stuff of a thing I already like, I haven't really been keeping up with, but I have watched the films because I'll take 90 minutes. Like I can take 90 minutes.
Yeah, it's a lot better than watching 5 episodes straight of Goku charging up his, you know, soul blast, whatever you call it, only to miss the bad guy.
Yeah. I mean, I just opened up Vudu and there is a Crunchyroll banner 4 slides down.
There you go.
Yeah, there's definitely like, and there are a lot more conversations about, especially like in these, this, you know, this streaming era, and with Crunchyroll being the preeminent anime streamer, because Crunchyroll was free for a long time. It was just like, you know, it was free. There were very few ads at first, and then it became, you know, it was primarily ad supported. And like they, I think maybe 3-4 years ago, definitely before the pandemic, launched a, you know, subscription tier. So people are definitely like, I think that especially people who are, you like got into streaming in the last few years, especially like, you know, because we were all forced to be inside for 8 months. A lot of people got into anime and like kind of saw that there's a lot more to offer there than, you know, your traditional like shonen stuff, the stuff that was big in the 90s in the US. You know, your shonen animes, your magical girl stuff. There's like a lot more than that. And there has been for a while, but now that it's accessible with, you know, the globalization of the internet, people are getting back into it. And I think it's cool. It's just not necessarily for me, even though my friend is trying to get me to watch One Piece, which if you were to watch One Piece continuously, I did the math, and it would take you 14 days. So almost exactly 2 weeks to watch all of One Piece, and it's not finished.
Here's what you do. You triple that time, so 42 days, and you only have it on while you sleep, because nobody is going to invest that amount of time into it. And if they do, you don't want to have anything to do with that person.
You're going to have all seven of the anime fans that listen to this podcast in your DMs and all the social media you don't use.
Bring them on.
I think that's going to wrap us up for this week. You can find links to these articles in the show notes and at MediaPlayNews.com. You can subscribe to the site's mailing list using the subscription link in the notes. You can email us directly at MediaPlayNewsPodcast@gmail.com to have your comment feature on the show, or find us on our Twitter account at PodcastMPN. If you like the show, leave us a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen to podcasts. We really appreciate it. I'm Charles Parkman.
I'm Charlie Shelley.
And we will see you next week. Peacock is doing more than live streaming premieres of their shows with their leads actors. That's a typo. It's on Charlie's end. I'm leaving it in.